interesting juxtaposition of dates, and I want to invite you, sometimes I say next week, next month, wrong, I want you to invite you to come back tomorrow. Same time, same place for the next event in our series, a rather important one, because this is designated as the third Dorothy J. and Richard W. Burkhart Lecture. Presentation will be given by Dr. William Cronin, who holds the esteemed and prestigious position as Frederick Jackson Turner Professor of History at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. A specialist in American environmental history and the history of the American West, Professor Cronin will base his illustrated lecture on his award-winning book, Nature's Metropolis, Chicago and the Great West. And I know you'll find Professor Cronin to be a very interesting and engaging scholar, and I certainly urge you to attend his slide narrative presentation tomorrow morning in this room at the same time. This morning, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you two state senators who will discuss environmental issues in the state of Indiana. Representing different political parties, but holding a common interest in the environment, Senators Pat Miller and Vi Simpson will share the podium to lend a statewide perspective to our series this year. Senator Miller, a Republican from Indianapolis, represents District 32, Johnson and Marion counties. Educated at Warren Central High School, Methodist Hospital School of Nursing and Indiana University, she is a registered nurse by occupation. Perhaps her earliest taste of politics occurred when she was first named delegate to the Republican State Convention in 1968 and then member of the Metropolitan Zoning Board of Appeals in 1972. At any rate, in 1982, she was elected to the House of Representatives for District 50, in 1983, elected by precinct committeemen to fill the vacant Senate seat for District 32. Since then, she has been regularly reelected to the Senate at four-year intervals, 1984, 1988, and of course, 1992. During her time in office, she has held membership on the following committees: Labor and Pensions, Education, Health, Welfare, and Aging, Health and Human Services, Interstate Cooperation as Chair, and Legislative Appointment and Elections as Ranking Member. Last year, she served as Chairman of Environmental and Consumer Affairs. Senator Simpson is a Democrat from Bloomington and represents District 40, which encompasses Brown, Greene, and Monroe counties. Educated at California State University, she is associated with Heritage Environmental Services of Indianapolis as their government services manager. Senator Simpson embarked on her political career as Monroe County Auditor in 1981. 3 years later, she was elected to the state Senate, where she was named Freshman Senator of the Year in 1985. She was reelected to the Senate in 1988 and again last Tuesday. Senator Simpson is the ranking Democrat on the Environmental and Consumer Affairs Committee and has also served on the committees for Finance and Natural Resources. On behalf of Ball State University, I certainly want to welcome both of them to this campus and to our series and then give you an explanatory note. Our format will be this. Each senator will present her own perspective on environmental issues in Indiana, and then I'll open the floor to questions and act as moderator. I certainly cordially invite all of you to participate in the discussion, and now I decided to begin in alphabetical order with Senator Miller. Pat.
Thank you very much, and it is my pleasure to be with you this morning. It's a very rainy morning, and it's Veterans Day, and I think all of us can pause to give thanks for our veterans and to all the persons who have served in the armed forces. Because without them, we would not have the freedom for Senator Simpson and myself to be here as citizen legislators to discuss environmental issues with you. So I'm very appreciative and grateful to be here this morning. There is little room as we talk about environmental issues for partisan politics. However, there are 150 members of the Indiana General Assembly. We represent the 92 counties in Indiana and more than 5 million people. And so as we gather in Indianapolis, we bring different philosophies as we come. The past few legislative sessions have demonstrated the complex nature of lawmaking in the 90s. Clearly, reaching a consensus is not an easy task with the various legislative agendas and differing political philosophies. They do usually surface during the legislative session. Democrats and Republicans frequently agree on what should be done to improve in the Indiana's environmental health, but we frequently disagree on the various approaches about how we accomplish those various tasks. these differences may become more apparent to you as I speak, and then as later Senator Simpson shares some of her points as well. As was already mentioned, I was appointed chairman of the Environmental and Consumer Affairs Committee in 1990, and Senator Simpson and I both serve on the Environmental Policy Commission, which has been looking at environmental issues now for a number of years. And I've come to understand the delicate process of trying to transform legislative agendas and ideas into good public policy that work for all Hoosiers. Environmental legislation is very complex and requires a broad range of expertise by those who are trying to craft this legislation. I think all of us want a clean, safe environment. As a registered nurse, I've spent a lot of my life interested in healthcare issues, and certainly environmental issues affect our health. But an interest in maintaining a healthy environment is only half of the equation. Technical and scientific knowledge is an important part of that as well. If we are going to come out with solid, good legislative proposals, we must understand the technology and the scientific knowledge that goes along with those proposals. So we depend a lot on other experts to bring and share with us at the legislative level ideas and concepts about how we deal with that. Additionally, we need a lot of open communication between environmental groups, regulators, the business community, the private sector, along with understanding the economy of environmental management. We all need to understand what is essential to execute good environmental policy. We go back to 1991, which is a session a year and a half ago. It appeared that that long session was one that it contained a lot of partisan bickering dealing with the state budget and legislative maps. But that session also produced several environmental initiatives. Among the initiatives enacted was a bill to require Indiana Department of Transportation to study the feasibility of using recycled materials such as asphalt and concrete in road construction. In the wake of the Green Revolution, legislators also approached a measure that would require those who advertise and label products with the claims as being recyclable or ozone-friendly had to file the supporting documentation with the Indiana Department of Environmental Management. We made a step in the right direction, I believe, in saying if you're going to make a claim, it must be supported by the facts. The legislature also approved measures at curbing out-of-state waste by setting good character requirements for solid waste transporters. In addition, a bill was enacted to impose fees on the final disposal of out-of-state solid waste in an effort to offset costs attributed to the importation and presence of solid waste in Indiana. And I suspect once again in 1993, legislation will again emerge trying to address the state's out-of-state waste law. As you know, the laws that we have passed have continued to be found to be unconstitutional by the courts. So until we enact more binding out-of-state trash legislation, cities like Gary and Fort Wayne are going to continue to be dumped on from out-of-state. Among some of the governor's initiatives included an environmental proposal which did fail, and I was a part of that. But it would ban all recyclables from final disposals or from landfills on certain dates. As you may be aware, this issue surfaced last year in 1992, but contained many of the fundamental concerns that I will address later, which were failed to be addressed in this legislation. The governor also proposed a measure which would have created artificial barriers for the final disposal of solid waste between solid waste districts within the state of Indiana, and I hope all of you are aware that the General Assembly did establish solid waste management districts for local units of government to deal with their own solid waste plan and disposal. Under the measure, there would have been differential fees that would have permitted parties with existing contracts to be exempted from that differential fee. Promoted as a way to stop out-of-state trash, the measure would have done little toward that end. Out-of-state brokers would have continued to dump in Indiana, and cooperation between solid waste management districts would have been undermined. Single county districts without a landfill would have been adversely affected. In 1990, we did pass Public Law 10, which, as I've already mentioned, established the solid waste management districts. There are currently 50 single county districts where the county is itself a solid waste management district. There are 10 multi-county districts, and those districts have submitted their plans to the state for approval. We have not seen all of those plans, but hopefully this will achieve the goal that the General Assembly wanted to be achieved. And that plan is to cover the next 20 years for the state of Indiana. Under a Republican initiative that gained bipartisan support, as well as support from the regulated community and the business community, there were specific time frames that would have established the Indiana Department of Environmental Management to approve or deny environmental permits. As you may or may not know, there has been a considerable lag time, and some of the permits have been for businesses to get permits to operate. Some of those go back to the 1980s. Last year, IDEM had a backlog of 5,000 permits pending since the early 1980s, which I've already mentioned to you. But committee testimony that we heard indicated that there are businesses that are going elsewhere to open or to operate a business because they can't get the environmental permit they need to operate in Indiana. We also had a bill, it was Senate Bill 399, which would have required legislative approval of IDEM's proposed environmental fees. The Department of Environmental Management had proposed large increases in the fees, which would have raised revenue by about $20 million. That bill passed the Senate but did not pass the House, and I suspect that you will see some legislation similar to that filed again in 1993. This year, state legislators were confronted with additional challenges as many environmental issues remained unresolved and very little time was available. You may be aware that 1992 was the shortest legislative session in the history of the state of Indiana. We ran 30 days consecutive, and we adjourned on February the 14th, which meant for the opportunity to resolve conflicts and bills at conference committee time or simply to hear bills was a very restricted amount of time. So it was a very, very, very short session. Of the 158 bills that passed during the 1992 session, six of those bills dealt with the environment. One measure would have helped preserve Indiana landfill space by restricting yard waste from landfills. It takes effect in October of 1994. Indianapolis, Marion County has already implemented that, and you may have heard a lot of the publicity. Some of it is not being well received by constituents, but preventing the bagging of leaves and plastic going to the incinerator in Marion County. Nevertheless, the yard waste ban bill did pass, and it will be in effect for the entire state October 1, 1994. It has been estimated that many Hoosier landfills will reach capacity and shut down within 7 years. According to a study done by IDEM, the state had 150 landfills in 1980. 10 years later, we only had 79 landfills, and that there are approximately 31 of those will close by 1993. Unless new landfills are built or existing landfills expanded, as many as 54 Hoosier counties could be without a readily accessible landfill by the end of this year. These counties will generate between 1.8 million and 3.2 million tons of solid waste annually, which is about 50% of the state's total waste stream. Before 1976, most yard waste was burned in private yards or at community disposal facilities. However, with the passage of the 1976 Federal Clean Air Act, open burning was discontinued and most communities began a disposal of yard waste in landfills. Because yard waste makes up approximately 20% of the trash in Indiana, passage of the legislation does help us reduce the waste stream and help to protect the landfill space that we have. Our goal is to reduce what goes into landfills by 35% by 1996 and 50% by the year 2001. It is likely that legislation will be introduced in 1993 to further clarify the yard waste legislation and to look at land application of composting. I always reluctant to use a lot of statistics, but you might be interested to know that every day Hoosiers discard 17,200 tons of refuse, which is more than 4% of the nation's total. The United States generates more solid waste per capita than any other nation in the world, and each American uses about 85 pounds of glass containers each year, and most of them are discarded after use. I believe that legislators are turning toward new and innovative waste reduction approaches. However, it is critical that we remain reasonable in our approach. While legislators must rely on interest groups to help us sort through the technological and complex environmental issues, we must be careful not to fall victim to political or unreasonable goals. This year's House Bill 1194, which is the bill I referred to which banned recyclables from landfills, is a good idea, but it failed to solve some of the other waste problems associated with it. For example, the bill banned such things as oil, large appliances, steel, aluminum, plastic, and glass containers, foam packaging, office paper, newsprint, magazines, household hazardous waste, and various other items from landfills. Unfortunately, the bill did not address such things as how we were going to deal with transportation, sorting, the infrastructure needed to carry this out, market development, and the use of consumers, the use by consumers to use recyclables. And that's one of the real major problems that we have is consumer use of recyclables. When it becomes profitable, businesses will get in the business of using products that they can sell for a profit. But until consumers are interested in buying those products, it becomes very difficult in the marketplace. Wisconsin is the only state that I'm aware of that it has the ban that was proposed last session of the General Assembly. And that bill, with testimony in our Senate committee, was that that bill initially cost $30 million to initiate it, and then as much as $50 to $60 million to carry it out afterwards. The bill before the Indiana Senate did not have money appropriated to carry out the bans. Republicans maintain that recycling projects will not be successful without a market for collectible recyclables. A comprehensive waste reduction plan involves more than just the collection and separation of recyclables from solid waste. The waste must be made into a usable product that can be sold. If the product cannot be sold and used, the cycle will break down and the market for recyclable waste will disappear or never appear to begin with. Recycling programs depend upon market availability, accessibility, material shipping and processing requirements, market stability and prices, market demand, and market competition. Recycling is a market-based activity. When consumers are willing to use recyclables, businesses will make money and markets will develop. I expect the language in this bill to be reintroduced, and I am confident that if we can resolve some of these other issues that were not addressed during the last session, I believe we can pass this legislation in some form, and I think we'll move a long way towards resolving some of the problems that we have with our waste disposal. I'll mention one issue which probably is very near and dear to the heart of Senator Simpson, and that deals with wetlands. Senator Simpson has carried a bill dealing with wetlands, and I think all of us want to protect our wetlands. Those are lands which hold water, and obviously they provide a place for wildlife and so on. And I think both political parties agree that we ought to protect our wetlands. However, the difference tends to be that those of us in the Republican caucus want some reimbursement and fairness for the property owners who have the wetlands, and for government to take property without giving a fair and equitable reimbursement to the property owner seems to be not a fair solution. I need to say that Senator Simpson and I have fought with each we have fought on opposite sides of issues like the wetland issue. We have fought arm in arm with issues like banning smoking in public places to protect clean air inside buildings. Most of these issues are not partisan issues. They are philosophical issues. And I think when you talk about these environmental issues, all of us, and I'm sure all of you in the room, may have some different approaches as how you would want them solved. And all of us do want to solve the environmental problems, not only in the state of Indiana, but in our country. By the same token, many of us still want all the luxuries and the opportunities to do the things the way that we do them now. We all like to go get into our automobiles whenever we like, go wherever we want. Often it's one of us in an automobile at a time. We like to take our wools or our clothes to the dry cleaners and have them cleaned and pick them up, understanding that those products that are used to clean our clothes have to be disposed of in some fashion. And so it's going to be a real educational process for all of us as consumers and citizens, as well as for government, to resolve the problem. In closing, I would just like to say that I don't believe government has the answer to all the environmental issues. I believe that the solution to the environmental problems will come from business and from a consumer-oriented climate. I don't believe that government has the creative genius to solve our environmental problems. Instead, I think the answer will be found and developed in a free enterprise marketplace. As chairman of the Senate Environmental and Consumer Affairs Committee, I have worked to learn more about environmental issues. Recently, I toured a bottling and recycling facility to see firsthand how they could reduce, reuse, and recycle. I've visited a landfill, a paper recycling plant, an engine company, a foundry, and many other facilities to find firsthand what it's like in the marketplace. And so I would say to all of you as informed citizens, I think it behooves you to bring ideas to people like myself and Senator Simpson and to members of the General Assembly. Bring us your thoughts and your ideas for new, innovative, and effective environmental programs and proposals that we can look at and evaluate and develop as public policy to help all of us improve the environment for the state of Indiana. So thank you very much. I look forward to your questions.
Good morning. It's nice to see so many of you here. We never know, you know, as politicians, when we walk into a room, whether there'll be three people or 300 people. So this is a nice group, and I hope we can have a nice dialogue and discussion as the morning progresses. I think Senator Miller gave you a fairly good overview of some of the accomplishments of the General Assembly, some of the accomplishments and failures of the General Assembly in the last several years. And I want to back up a little bit farther and give you some historical perspective on the state's role in environmental regulation and environmental protection. Because as few as 8 to 10 years ago, the state of Indiana was basically an enforcement mechanism for federal legislation. We had some responsibility for RCRA and some responsibility for CERCLA and TSCA and all those other wonderful acronyms that had just kind of fall in together, Clean Water, the existing Clean Air Act, and some of the other environmental protection attempts at the federal level to make some progress in the environmental arena. But then some things happened during the next couple of years in the state of Indiana, or at least around the state of Indiana, that I think kind of moved us from where we were, which was just a reactive or responsive kind of government, to one that actually has made some progress. One of the things that we did, I believe in 1985, at least right after I first got to the legislature, was the creation of the Department of Environmental Management. Before that, the State Board of Health had responsibility for protecting the environment and for implementation of the Clean Water Act and some other things. And the Department of Natural Resources had some responsibility, not very much, but some. And of course, the State Board of Health had this myriad of responsibilities, something like 50 or 60 kinds of issues that were the responsibility of the State Board of Health. And one of those was the protection of the environment, a huge technical problem that was looming out there. And the State Board of Health was really not in a position, in my opinion, to give it the attention, the budgetary influence or any of those other things that it deserved. And so we pulled it out of the State Board of Health and took a lot of the people and took the poor budgetary dollars as well, and created the Department of Environmental Management, which I think has focused a lot of attention, good attention, bad attention, but attention nevertheless. You take it where you can get it, and we have built on that. So that was one thing. And then we went through this period of a lot of media attention of events, you know, needles floating up on the Long Island beaches and solid waste barges, trash barges floating around looking for a home. And all kinds of things happened at during this same period of time that focused a lot of attention again of the citizenry, of the public, on environmental issues in general. All of that culminated in the second Earth Day. Some of you in this room are old enough to remember the first Earth Day in 1970. We had a second one in 1990, and suddenly everybody was an environmentalist, and everybody, this issue really caught fire. And it was gratifying for those of us who had been working in this area for a while to have lots of company, but to tell you the truth, there, we also had a lot of bad legislation introduced because everybody got excited and everybody wanted to have an environmental bill of their own. And when you have a flood of environmental bills, we went from, in 1985, I think there were four, maybe five so-called environmental bills introduced in the General Assembly. In 1990, there were over 100 introduced by people who, forgive me, but it's true, I think Pat will agree with this, couldn't even spell environment until, you know, 1990 when they attended their first Earth Day celebration. So, you know, we had this kind of good thing, bad thing happening, which was this, you know, new consciousness that was not only happening out in the electorate, but also happening internally with our colleagues. But then we also had some of the bad fallout from that, some of the bad results. And then another thing happened, which I think is very, very important specifically in Indiana, and that was this recognition that we were becoming the importer of out-of-state waste. And everyone raised up and wanted to arm themselves and keep that nasty, awful New Jersey trash back in New Jersey where it belongs and don't bring it to the pristine landfills of Indiana. And so all of this happened within a period of 4 to 6 years, and increased the state's involvement then and in developing our own public policy in the environmental area. We did some really excellent work, I think, in the hazardous waste area. We did some fairly good work in water back a few years ago, and then in the last couple of years we've made some significant progress, as Senator Miller related to you, in the area of solid waste management. It is not a usual thing for Indiana to be a leader in some of these more progressive legislative areas, but I'm happy to say that in solid waste management area, Indiana really became a leader and progressed ahead of some of our sister states in the Midwest in the development of solid waste districts and setting goals for waste reduction, and some of those approaches, as we are actually in the implementation now, I think will continue to put Indiana in a leadership role in that particular area. In a little while, I'll talk about some of the other areas, because sometimes when we talk about the environment, we all get trapped into thinking that solid waste management and trash and garbage is the extent of our environmental involvement, when in fact we all know that the environment is much more complicated than that and includes many, many subject areas. Clean air, indoor clean air is one of those that Senator Miller was a pioneer in, actually, a few years ago, much to the dismay of many of our colleagues. and she's still taking a little heat for that. But I want to get away from some of the specific issues to talk a little bit about how the relationship of the players in the environmental arena has changed in Indiana. Because I think that's probably the most notable change that we've seen in the last several years. And when I talk about the players, I'm talking about the regulated community, who I used to think were just industries, but I have learned to also include municipalities and some of the other permit holders in that regulated community who contribute to the pollution. And by the way, even though we're not regulated as individual citizens, we certainly are big contributors, and I think we need to always keep that in mind. So we have the regulated community as one of the major players in the environmental arena. And then we have the regulators who include in Indiana the Department of Environmental Management, the Department of Natural Resources, still the State Board of Health in certain areas, and the Agriculture Department and the State Chemist and a long list. You would be surprised at how many people are actually involved in environmental protection, regulation, or implementation of state policy. And then a third group, which is kind of led by the environmentalist voices. And they're led by that group not because of significant numbers particularly, but because there are organizations who are there, who are organized, who then become the spokespersons for the environmental movement. I like to think that the environmentalists, however, include most of us as citizens, but the level of awareness and the level of political activity is just different and in different places. But that group is certainly a third player. When we first started, excuse me, we don't have any water in here, do we? Thank you. This weather wreaks havoc on my voice. there may be nothing left. I'm sorry. When we first, Jean, I was doing so well, too. When we first started the environmental issues in any serious way in the Indiana General Assembly, we saw those three players as adversaries. And most of us, I came to the legislature as part of the environmentalist group. Thank you. That's perfect. Thank you very much. I apologize. Every once in a while, my voice just totally gives out when it's raining. Most people have joints and things that hurt, you know, when it rains, but Vi's voice just totally gives out. And in this, we saw ourselves in adversarial positions. I came to the legislature as an advocate of the environmentalist position. Thank you. And there were others in the legislature who represented other pieces of that pie. Some represented the administration, whether it be the Republican or Democrat administration in representing the interests of the regulators, and then there are others who feel more comfortable with the business position and, you know, represented the interests of the regulated community. But we had this adversarial kind of focus, and so we fought all the time. You know, sometimes you meet your expectations, and in this case, I think we did. We also didn't make a lot of progress because we fought all the time. It became, and I'd like to mention also that we came to that process with this lack of trust in one another. The enviros didn't trust the government to protect them, and the government didn't trust the industry to help police or to help set policy for their industry, and the industry didn't trust the enviros because they're all crazy and they have no science basis upon which to have their crazy positions, and so it just kind of fed on each other, and and got to the place where we were making absolutely no progress at all. But the issue over the last half dozen years or so has really matured. And it, with that maturity came an understanding amongst all three of those groups that if we are going to make any progress at all, that we need to try to throw off that lack of trust and try to come together to reach some common goals. So I want to say that for me personally, that meant not caring so much about someone's motivation, about why we wanted to get to a particular goal. I used to care about why Eli Lilly, for instance, wanted to get... Sorry, I'm having a hard time up here. This podium's not big enough. Usually I walk and pace when I'm talking. I used to care why Eli Lilly wanted to change a particular law, instead of looking carefully at what that change entailed. And was that a plus for the environment? Which was it a plus for the my constituents, for the people that I represent, or not? And so once you could get away from the motivation, what is the environmentalist motivation and what is Eli Lilly's motivation, once you can get away from that and figure out where you can reach common goals, then you find it a lot easier to work together to get there. And in the last couple of years, I think that's the most significant progress that we've made as a state, is bringing those people together around the same table and saying, look, this is the goal. This is where we want to get to. And if that means that Ball Corporation makes a whole bunch of money, well, that's okay, as long as we get to the goal. And if it means that the environmentalists accomplish what they want and the regulators accomplish what they want, it's okay. Everybody can feel safe and easy as long as we reach these common goals. Now, that's not to say we always agree. As Pat explained to you, we don't always agree. But we do get to some areas of commonality, and we get to some areas of progress that I count as real progress. And that's a very important step forward. So we have reduced some of that adversarialness, and I think that's a very important prediction for how we'll handle some of these issues in the future. I want to talk about those three players a little bit more, to talk about if I were in charge of the world, how I would like these three players to change their attitudes and how I would like to see us deal with environmental policy in the future. In the regulated community, I'd like them to be able to figure out that in the long run, they're not always going to win every battle. In the past, an industry, for instance, was not in the mood to negotiate or find compromise if they knew they could kill the legislation without even trying. All they had to do was talk to a committee chairman or talk to the Speaker of the House or, you know, and this is true of any special interest group that is very plugged in. If they knew up front that they could kill the bill, What's the motivation for compromise? The truth is that hardly anybody can do that anymore on this issue. And that's because even committee chairmen and even speakers of the House and president pro tems and even the governor have to be open to the wishes and desires and demands of the constituency. And this is an issue that has grown not only with my colleagues in the legislature, but certainly with the constituency, the electorate out there. And people are demanding that we take some action. And no matter how powerful one might be as a regulated person, a regulated entity, no matter how powerful they might be in the legislative process, their power is reduced by the electorate's power being expressed. And so I'd like them to understand that they're not going to win every battle. They're not going to win, which to me is great motivation for having them come to the table. I'd like them to understand that we depend on them to take a leadership role in this area, because the state and the feds, to a certain extent, don't have the resources or the technical expertise, nor will we ever have the resources, in my opinion, to do this on our own. It cannot be accomplished at the governmental level, even though perhaps it would be quicker and more direct if it happened that way. We will not have the resources to do it and to do it right. Therefore, we have to depend on the regulated community to help get us to where we need to be. And thirdly, we're going to hear a lot, I think, with the new administration in Washington about economics, the relationship between jobs and the economy and economic development and the environment. And I am a believer in that philosophy, that you can do both, that we can plan for both, that we can have a growing economy and still protect our environment. We have to just do things differently than we've done them in the past, but we can do both. To the regulators, I would like the regulators to stop seeing themselves as the police and start seeing them police who are underfunded and have no authority or any power, basically, in the state of Indiana. So they're weak police, which is even worse. I'd like to see them stop seeing themselves in that role and start seeing themselves as the potential for a clearinghouse of information, as the potential for being the facilitator, bringing people together to resolve differences, as the focus for technical expertise and technical information that can be shared so that we can get to some of the common goals that we all have in mind. And I would like to see this administration and future administrations take an assertive leadership role in not only solid waste management, but in lots of areas that we have yet to address in the state. But I want to save my last remarks for environmentalists. And I assume that a lot of you are here because you also come from that interest area. Perhaps you have some organization that you belong to or some activity that you participate in, and you too are an environmentalist. And I think it's real important for environmentalists, and I count myself in that group, to pick our fights a little better. I think that there are important issues that need to be resolved, but there are times that we have to learn to compromise and negotiate. We have to be patient. We have to pick our fights, because there are some that are very important and some that are less important. Let me tell you, give you a couple of examples. One of my favorites is the whole debate over whether we should use cloth diapers or disposable diapers. And I used to have some real strong feelings about that. And I won't get into all of those because that's a whole nother lecture about whether we should use cloth diapers or disposable diapers. But the issue is much bigger, much greater. We need to think in terms, rather than picking that particular fight, perhaps we need to look better at the real cost of cloth diapers. Perhaps we need to start thinking in terms of expanding our thinking to outside of the solid waste area to energy and water and some of the other areas that are impacted by cloth diapers as opposed to disposable diapers. Let me give you another example, one that's in the news all the time. And I bet if we took a poll in here, you'd all say that this was a big problem in the state of Indiana, and that's out-of-state waste. We are a net importer of out-of-state waste. There is only one landfill in the state of Indiana that is now accepting out-of-state waste. We have done a very good job, frankly, of reducing that waste stream. But it is not nearly as big an issue as the newspapers would have you believe it is. It is a much smaller issue than the fact that Indiana citizens are not reducing our waste stream, that Indiana consumers are still going to the grocery store and wanting all kinds of plastic and saran and all these materials covering up our products to make them beautiful and to make them safe. And it is not nearly as big an issue as some of the other things that we have totally neglected in the last couple of years, like watershed protection and clean air and the lack of energy policy of any kind in the state of Indiana and in the nation for that matter. So what I'm saying is we need to do, as environmentalists, a better job of picking our fights. There are battles worth waging out there, and then there are others that are just newspaper hits. And we need to be better informed about which is which and spend our time and our energy and our resources on the things that really count. So, what are some of the things that really count? In the next legislative session, we'll be implementing, or hopefully we'll be about to implement, the Federal Clean Air Act requirements for the state of Indiana. This could be a major, major issue in the state over the next 2 years. Have you been reading anything about it? Have you heard anything about it? Have we as legislators spent any time on Clean Air Act implementation? Very little. Very little. And to me, this is one of the most important pieces of legislation that we will be faced with in the next decade, perhaps. The whole issue of watersheds and wetlands, Senator Miller talked about it. We are trying very hard to get together a consensus group to put together a piece of compromise legislation so that we can begin to reduce the destruction of wetlands in the state of Indiana. And we have chosen a pilot project, which I hope will be funded in the next session, so that we can start figuring out how to better regulate and govern our watersheds and stop thinking about groundwater, surface water, wetland protection, and all of these ways we divide up water, water quantity, water quality, flood control, lake enhancement, all of those things that really are have to do with watersheds and watershed protection. To me, that is going to be the key area in the next decade, perhaps, watershed protection. And in the other area that we'll hear a lot of talk about in the next couple of years will be market development, which is the key area for the state in the whole solid waste management area. It is the one place where we have really not made a whole lot of progress in the solid waste area, and it is the one place where the state can do the most to help. And we need to do that because, as you all know, recycling is not collection. Recycling is a circle, and we have to close the loop. We haven't done that yet in Indiana. Okay, so those are some of the fights that are worth fighting, in my opinion, and the ones that that I hope we will be able to bring all of the players to the table to resolve. And with that, we'll be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
All yours, I'm sure, with some of those comments and a bit of a preview of some of the things that are coming up. You may have some comments or questions to continue the discussion. Both of our guests are here. Not often you get to have this in the same room with two senators of such influence. Yes.
I was on the solid waste advisory board in my area, and we spent hours and hours doing a plan, which we felt was a compromise. There were some on the board, like myself, who were from the environmental community. There were many people on the board that were from other areas of business and so on. Just because our county has no tipping fees, it raised the tax rate, I think, $8 to $9 per year on the average citizen. That plan then was passed on to the state tax board, and they basically cut the budget in half and said, now, he'll go ahead and implement the program even though you've got half the money to deal with. Most of that program that we developed, a lot of it was education, kind of the area I'm in. And, you know, to me, this is a perfect example of how, instead of looking ahead and saying, we'll pay for this now, we're going to pay for it later, you know, and much more severely on down the road.
I don't know if either of us has the answer to long-range planning in government, but I think your problem is not so much long-range planning, because I think the legislature...
long-range planning as far as the solid waste management districts. The problem is the tax board, which is one unit of government, not understanding what the other unit of government has said to local people, we want you to put together your plan, and then if you get support from your local community, you run with the plan. What the tax board has said, they're not recognizing that authority. And often what we do as legislators is we go back next year and fix the problem that we didn't resolve the last time, and that solid waste management plan, we've changed it two or three times since it passed to try to give the local governing body more authority, and that may be something that we have to do is go back and give you more authority yet. Senator Simpson may want to expand on that.
Well, as she said, you really are talking about two different things that are related, but just in general terms, the whole issue of long-range planning is an impossibility for legislators, I think. And maybe it is even for the executive branch to a certain extent, because we think in two-year and four-year increments, and anything that's longer than that is just out of the realm of our, you know, thinking cap. And one of the reasons for House Bill 1240, which is the solid waste management planning bill, when we first thought about it, was to make local governments do what the state government could never do, and that is think about one narrow issue over a 20-year period. And those local plans are to address an issue for 20 years into the future, which is unheard of. Absolutely unheard of in government. And I don't believe that elected state officials who have to run for office every 2 years or 4 years are in any way set up to, the process itself is not set up for long-range thinking. And I think that's a real shame. One of the things we've tried to do with the Environmental Policy Commission is to think in terms of long-term, long-range environmental policy. And we've not been able to accomplish it. And so this next year, what we're going to do is divide up the Environmental Policy Commission into a legislative bunch that thinks in terms of short-term legislative solutions, and then try and get lay people to come in who have some expertise and interest to try and make recommendations for long-term planning. Because I just believe politicians aren't capable of thinking past the next election.
Well, comes as a great surprise. Go ahead, Pat.
Yeah. I've been watching an increase in the staffing at Office of Pollution Prevention at IBM, and I think very favorably disposed to that, and see this as an increase in the working relationship between business, industry, and regulator. Is this an example of how you're talking about the shift in from a regulatory agency, police agency, to one that is more of a clearinghouse of information?
Yeah, did you hear his question? So, talking about the Office of Pollution Prevention in the Department of Environmental Management. That was due to legislation, though. So I'll give us credit for that. Senator Tony Maidenberg and Senator Ed Pease, unfortunately, both of them are no longer with us in the Senate. But both of them together worked with the regulated community and the regulators to come up with that piece of compromise legislation to try and move the department from a police agency, one of enforcement, toward one of technical assistance and prevention, which to me is the place where we should put most of our dollars. I mean, Pat and I share an interest in healthcare and preventive healthcare measures as a way of getting a handle on long-term cost containment for healthcare. And I think the same is true, maybe even more true, in the environmental area. We have to put our dollars into prevention because we are so far behind
as far as cleaning up, that it seems to me when you have limited resources that it's better to not cause any more problems than it is to try and clean up, because we will never catch up with cleanup. We will never catch up with cleanup. And the very best we can do right now is spend our dollars on prevention.
Yeah, I think Senator Simpson's comments earlier about the adversarial relationship, particularly between the regulated community and regulators. Regulators ought to be helping. They ought to be there to help to improve. And unfortunately, sometimes, rightly or wrongly, those people being regulated are suspicious of those who are coming in because it is the police atmosphere, as opposed to, I'm here to help you, we want to improve the environment. It's that we're here to find you doing something wrong and we're going to really stick a big fine on you. So I think that's part of the problem. I'd like to say, too, Senator Simpson mentioned a company, and I wasn't going to mention that company, but I did bring a chart with me. Monday, I toured a Pepsi-Cola plant, and you can drink Coke or Pepsi, whatever you want. But one of the things that I was very impressed with is what they had done, and I brought their chart to show you, is in their reduction of the waste that they have in their plant, it would used to cost them, and this was in 1989, $75,000 to dispose of their waste. In 2 years, they went from $75,000 to $25,000, and this year they're down to about $12,000. And it was very impressive to walk around that plant, see very few barrels, see very few things where they're disposing things, see them using plastic crates and carts or whatever to move things on, because those things are reusable. They don't have to even be recycled. They're reusable. They have significantly reduced the packaging and explain how they load the trucks now and all the things that they do to prevent this 2 and 3 and 4 layer of packaging. And their employees, they've put in so that the employees that are working actually in the plant are the ones that are developing the plan and the proposal. But what was really interesting was to see what they've done with the plastic bottles when you buy the large liter bottles. On Monday, going through this Pepsi-Cola plant, they said, you know what, they're making all these plastic bottles now. And I said, no. They said, carpet. Yesterday, I was at the Senate. The Secretary of the Senate was showing me all these carpet samples because we're going to get new carpet in some rooms that will go in one of the rooms down the hall.
These Republicans are such big spenders.
Yeah, right. But it's for the Democrat members of the Democrat caucus. But at any rate, she said, she said, guess what this carpet's made out of? And I said, plastic. And she said, how did you know? Well, I didn't tell her because I was at Pepsi plant the day before, and they told me.
You're smart.
Yeah. But I think the important thing is that this is really business, and the ingenuity and the creativity, and it, you know, if business can make a profit, they are going to be very, very creative, and they're going to come up with a lot of ideas that those of us in government won't come up with. What we have to do is have the business climate, the public policy climate, so that business and industry and people like you will be creative and come up with the ideas. Legislators will not come up with the ideas. What we will do is give approval for how those things take place. So, you know, it's a very exciting time to be involved with environmental issues. You know, what's going to happen in the next 10 to 20 years will be phenomenal as we move through, and there are going to be some remarkable things happen, like we saw in transportation. You know, my father's 83. He has lived from before horse and buggy time to putting someone on the moon. And I think in the environmental arena, in the next few decades, you're going to see tremendous change that none of us anticipate.
Mm-hmm. Are those costs then going to be passed on to the consumer in the form of price reductions at the supermarket?
I would certainly hope so. I think as you see more competition, obviously in this case, I'm sure Pepsi, if they can sell more Pepsi because of cost reduction than Coke, you will see those kinds of things. I can't stand here and tell you exactly what companies are going to do, but I think we are in a free market economy where business wants to be competitive and they want to do well, and I think you will see those things translated for consumers.
Other, yeah, yes, Pam?
Recycling, of course, the key place to claim where we should be looking at waste management issues in the way of not having anything we have to worry about recycling any longer. And I know that the marketplace is very important, but it seems to me that in terms of waste management, our legislature should be doing things to encourage waste management. So are there any thoughts in
a couple of ideas. We were talking about prevention a little earlier, and that's certainly waste reduction and source reduction are probably the most important things we can do. First of all, House Bill 1240, which is really the basis of all of the solid waste discussion, has in it the waste reduction goals of 35% and 50% that Senator Miller mentioned. So by the year 2000, we have to reduce our waste stream going to final disposal. And there are a number of ways to do that. And what the legislation sets out in statute, which doesn't seem very revolutionary to you perhaps, but to us a couple of years ago, it was a pretty big deal. It sets out a hierarchy of emphasis. And it begins with waste reduction. Waste reduction and then reuse. And some of the other things that are listed in at that end of the hierarchy, recycling is fairly far down the list because there are costs to recycling. She asked about passing cost savings on to consumers. Maybe that will happen at some time. But the truth is, right now, recycling costs money. What she was referring to is the cost savings to an industry for not having your waste taken away by waste management or, you know, Rumpke or somebody. But in truth, the people who are actually running recycling programs are finding out that the markets aren't there and that they have to pay to have stuff taken away. We haven't developed the whole loop yet. And so recycling costs money. Besides those kinds of costs, recycling requires some kinds of processing, which has byproducts, some of which are very good, like, for instance, de-inking of newspapers or bleaching of papers in a recycling process, have environmental consequences that have to be measured. So in my opinion, recycling is down the list. So I agree with what you're saying. That we have a couple of task forces that have been formed either by legislation or administratively in the last couple of years that are now coming together with their reports, suggestions for legislation, suggestions for administrative changes that deal with packaging. One of them deals with packaging reduction, one of them with newsprint and other paper things, and another with waste tires, which is a huge problem in the state of Indiana. And there are some really wonderful creative, innovative suggestions in those task force reports that I hope we will adopt. But it will require some legislative action, and many of them are going to require some dollars to be spent by the state government, and that will require the legislature and the governor, frankly, to bite the bullet and spend some money. And I guess we'll see what we're all made of in the next session.
We need to draw this to a close. I again want to thank you so very much for taking the time from your schedules to join us. So please join me. Thank you very much for coming. If you can come back tomorrow, Bill Cronin, 11 o'clock, same place.
Thank you.